Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and family of the graduates, faculty, gathered alumni, and honored guests, it is an honor to open these commencement exercises of the year 2019, the ninth year in our school's history. Tonight, we are gathered at the close of another academic year to confirm that all of these members of the class of 2019 have completed Anthem Preparatory Academy's course of studies, an accomplishment which we, the assembled faculty of the Academy, are proud to attest. Tonight, we celebrate this great achievement and graduate our seniors. It is tradition that the leading member of the class is invited to deliver the farewell address or valedictory speech. The valedictorian, selected by the faculty, is the bearer of the single highest honor that the school can bestow on any of our students. This year, the Academy recognizes co-valedictorians, Ms. Sabrina Seifert and Mr. Noah Bettard. Both of these students began their Great Hearts education, as many of my fifth grade students, during the year of the wild hare. I have taught both Ms. Seifert and Mr. Bettard many times over the years and have come to know and appreciate both of them very much. First, Ms. Seifert has served the community well over the years. She is confident and outspoken advocate of the students. She always presses herself to surmount every obstacle and has continually shown a desire to help those around her, whether in or outside of the Academy. Her enthusiasm and spirit will be missed in our halls. I now welcome Sabrina Seifert to the podium to give her valedictory speech.
Thank you, Mr. Goodrich. Good evening, everyone. First and foremost, I would like to personally congratulate the class of 2019. Give yourselves a hand. Just 4 years ago, we wore those Oxford shirts for the first time, and today for the last. Only we aren't the same people anymore. We have changed, matured, and have grown into the young adults we are today. This evolution is thanks to many people around us and the people we've encountered during high school, and I would like to take some time to recognize a couple of them. To begin, I want to thank all the families here tonight. Thank you for being there for and taking pride in your graduates throughout their high school careers and throughout their lives. I know that your confidence in them and your love for them means the world. I would also like to take a moment to thank my own family for loving and supporting me always and for inspiring me to put my heart and soul into everything that I do. Thank you for coming to every choir concert, soccer game, tennis match, and for constantly reminding me that I can be anything that I want to be and do anything that I want to do with a little hard work and dedication. And of course, our school would be nothing without its teachers, staff, and faculty. The entire faculty is so caring and hardworking day in and day out. The educators within this school genuinely care about the success of every single one of their students. Many of these selfless individuals get to school hours early to prepare and tutor, stay late to offer even more help, run clubs, fulfill after-school activities, and duties. And after such a long day, you think these people would be eager to get home, but you'll see the same teachers at the basketball game later. This just goes to show how honestly outstanding our teachers are at Anthem Prep. The teachers we have here aren't merely lecturers. They are their student supporters, mentors, as well as leaders and cultivators of school spirit and culture. For all this and more, I would like to sincerely thank the entire Anthem Prep faculty. Your unrivaled commitment to your students has made me and the graduates before you who we are today. And for that, we are grateful. Thank you. I would next like to recognize my friends and classmates, Anthem Prep's class of 2019. I'm not going to exaggerate and say that we were all best friends, but I will argue that throughout the past 4+ years, we have become a family. We know each other's faces, names, and personalities. I know for a fact that I've had a conversation with every single one of you at one point or another, and although we might not get along all the time, I've shared moments, classes, and memories with each one of you that I will never forget. I can say with confidence that whether we were the best of friends or not, I am grateful to have had you in my life, all of you. Again, I argue we are like a family. No family is perfect, and you're often closer to some than you are to others. But at the end of the day, you appreciate each single member, and you wish the very best for them. And so, I reiterate, I am grateful to have known each and every one of you, and I will never forget you, and I wish you the very best in all of your endeavors. Now, the words I've spoken thus far on this stage tonight have become part of your memory. I'm never going to say them again, and even if I did, I could never say them in exactly the same way, nor would they affect you the same way, because you've already heard them. The moment is gone, but is forever in your memory. And high school, too, now, is only a memory. You'll never be dress-coded for wearing the wrong colored socks again. You'll never play Un Don Dean in Spanish, get hit by Mr. Curry's marker cap, or splatter paint all over yourself in art ever again. You won't need to ask to go to the bathroom, ask your parents to sign you out, and actually, you don't need to come back to the school ever if you don't want to. You'll never experience your first day of high school, and today, your last, ever again. You will never have classes with, eat lunch in the commons with, and explore Washington, D.C. with these same 38 people who you've grown up with ever again. You'll never be right here, right now, ever again. And yes, it's sad, but this is just what makes moments so special. Each one is unique and fleeting. It will never come again, so now they are memories. And as we all prepare to close one chapter of our lives and begin the next, I encourage you to cherish all the memories you have made thus far, to appreciate and learn from your past experiences. But at the same time, I urge all of you to live now, because before you know it, in another 4 years, you'll be in a completely different place. And this moment right here, and these people right here, will be just a memory. So thank you, faculty, teachers, fellow students of Anthem Prep, for all of the memories. And I hope that you live every day like it's your last. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Seifert. Now, Mr. Bedard has a quiet compassion towards all except those who have found themselves deserving of his smoldering righteous indignation. In his time with us, he has served our community very well in ways including supporting many struggling students through peer tutoring and by comforting many a downtrodden classmate. He is beloved by all and will be missed by all. I now welcome Mr. Noah Bedard to the podium to give his valedictory speech.
So hello, everyone. Tonight has been incredibly exciting. But before I get into my speech, I do want to thank a few people. Firstly, I want to thank my parents for the steadfast kindness that they have always given me, always encouraging me to learn in every way I can. I also want to thank the incredible teachers of Anthem Prep. for inspiring us all to seek the truth in every way possible. Without your efforts, many of us would have been unaffected by the gravity of what we have learned. Whether it be contemplating the nature of the soul or balancing an equation, a love for learning can be kindled by the excitement of the teacher concerning the truth. And lastly, I want to thank my friends, the class of 2019. It still blows my mind that we're officially graduates. After all, some of us have known each other ever since the fifth grade, or even prior to that. But now, upon this day, we must depart. While this is a time of immense sorrow, it's also one of great hope as well, a hope for the future, of coming opportunity. Yet, we still shouldn't forget the memories and the lessons we have learned that have brought us to this point. So you know what? We should go down a trip down memory lane. For good old time's sake, might as well. In the beginning, there was freshman year, a time of transition. From start to finish, much of that year was enjoyable. After all, this was when we first began our humane letters class. Many of our friendships from middle school continued to flourish, and puns were still socially acceptable, especially in Ms. Guthmiller's class. But you know what? One of my favorite memories actually happened in my poetry class. They see where we're going with this. So one day, we were writing a poem about a pillar that Mr. Goodrich had pushed down, and it shattered into about a quadrillion pieces, which is a story for another time. But, so we were writing this poem, right? And the entire class was in an uproar, because we were trying to rhyme a line that ended with the word fall. So, in that case, we were squabbling, and after about 5 minutes, a student who is dear to us all, Nicole Shibata, quiets the class to a dead silence. And then she, with unflinching hesitation, says, "Let's rhyme fall with pillar." Down to the letter. While this memory is very fond to me, I think it also brings great moral insight. Don't be afraid to speak up for what you believe to be right, even if the results aren't what you anticipate. After all, in the end, you might be brought close to the live truth. And yes, we did use that line in the final version of our poem, and it was amazing. So, next was sophomore year, and it was both the best of times and the worst of times, in the words of Charles Dickens. It was during this time when many of us really started to think about college, which I would say leads to a little bit of stress. Also, this year was, at least for my class, the year when there was 11 ladies and 2 guys in choir, which is about as awkward as you might think. But it was good nevertheless. But one memory that will forever be burned into my mind is the final problem of the pre-calculus midterm in Dr. Brungart's class. I think everyone struggled with that test. Except Sneha, of course, but other than that, yeah. But you know what? Throughout all these situations, there was something to be learned. Perseverance in seeking the truth, while possibly and probably painful, will always culminate into a worthwhile reward. No questions asked. Even if the good is locked behind difficult moral quandaries or practical ideas. In relation to junior year, it was an era of opportunity and investment, while still having its fair share of good fun. I will never apologize for the fun I had discussing philosophy that year. But what can I say? Most of it's Greek to me. But in truth, one of the times that I think brought our class most together was the final project of Mrs. Shields' physics class. During that time, we were studying the nature of sound, right? So we had to prepare a song. And we chose Here Comes the Sun by the Beatles. And you know what? While not all of us were experienced in the realm of music, especially me, there was no judgment. While there might have been some treble along the way, there was only encouragement. And if I may be honest, this was only a singular instance of a mindset that most of us had adopted for the entire year. That being calm guidance, can inspire all to traverse the odyssey of life and give them the opportunity to explore new ventures. It's this mindset of humble understanding that we have learned. And now here we are, at the end of our senior year of high school. If I may be honest, some of my favorite memories with y'all come from the senior trip. For instance, when there was that 3-hour delay for our plane ride to DC, no one complained. Rather, as a community, we came together and made the best out of the situation we were given. And as a confession, it was a lot of fun. And of course, who could forget running back to the metro after seeing the monuments by night? If I may say thank you again, Mr. Wood, for finding a certain person's wallet who dropped it along the way. You saved her a lot of stress. But in truth, one of my favorite memories has to be that of the final seminar. I think it was then when we were closest. Because no matter how we differed in opinions or beliefs, everyone was given a respectful hearing. From this, I think we can derive a moral lesson that's invaluable. Being able to listen to others, even if you disagree with them completely, while still being able to care for them, is a sign of true maturity. I think we've all learned that. I'm proud to say that. As one chapter ends, another must begin. No matter what you pursue, I know that each and every one of you will achieve it with excellence, always seeking the good, the true, and the beautiful. You know, I'm proud to be a part of this family. I wouldn't have traded it for the world. All the friendships we've made, all the memories we've created, they've only bettered us. Unintentional pun there. If I could be predictable, since y'all know me and my nature, and quote Psalm 139:14, which says, "I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know this well." Don't forget that. Don't forget that you're wonderfully made, each and every one of you, with a purpose in this world. Well, tonight, we must go separate ways. The memories we have made over these past years will ever remain in our souls. You know, we've all been given a pen, in a way. So go on and write the rest of your story, chapter after chapter. And you know what? It'll be done well, because we're the class of 2019. Thank you for listening.
I do have to comment and say, as I watched that pillar shatter on the ground, I thought, this is either one of the best moments I've, decisions I've made as a teacher, or one of the worst. And it comes back to haunt me. Thank you, Mr. Bedard. Now, Anthem Prep is especially honored to have with us here tonight as commencement speaker, Mr. Andrew Ellison. Mr. Ellison was the founding headmaster of the first Great Hearts Academy, Veritas Preparatory Academy. He spent many years leading this community until stepping up to lead Great Hearts on a larger scale as the assistant superintendent of upper schools in Phoenix. He now serves as the executive director in Great Hearts, Texas. Regardless of position, Mr. Ellison has been a visionary leader since the beginning of Great Hearts. We can all thank him for much of what Great Hearts is today. We're always grateful for his modeling of what it is to be a lover of learning in all situations, and you'll be hard-pressed to find anyone in the Great Hearts Network who has not been inspired by him. I now invite Mr. Ellison to the podium to give the commencement address.
Mr. Goodrich, thank you very much for those humbling and kind words of introduction. Ms. Seifert and Mr. Bedard, thank you very much for your remarks. And Mr. Bedard, I pray that I never am the object of your smoldering righteous indignation. Truly fearsome. I bring greetings to this community from deep in the heart of the Lone Star State, and especially from our beloved founder and friend, Mr. Brian Smith, here, first headmaster of Anthem Prep, and wife Catherine. I was informed just before the ceremony began that today is, in fact, Mr. Smith's birthday. And if he were here, I would spontaneously lead us all in singing happy birthday to him. He is not. I will spare you that that torment. But I do want to share with you, this wasn't really part of my plan, Mr. Smith and his wife are actually leaving Great Hearts this year. They will be moving on, taking their family to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where Dr. Catherine Smith has obtained a faculty position at Eastern University there. So even as Anthem Prep said farewell to the beloved Smiths a few years back, Great Hearts is now bidding them farewell as they head off for the East Coast. But there's much ado in Texas. I will not share with you all of it. Many old friends there, Mr. and Mrs. Altaga and others. Mr. and Mrs. Ferris, although they're not teaching for Great Hearts anymore, they're just up the road from San Antonio, where Mr. Ferris will hopefully soon be Dr. Ferris in a wonderful degree program there at the University of Texas in Austin. But I am here to speak to y'all as an Anthem Prep community and to share some reflections on this occasion of commencement 2019. And graduates, I think you will recognize that when Great Hearts schools get together, we usually do a good job on occasions like this of talking about literature, talking about philosophy. We don't do nearly a good enough job of talking about mathematics and science on occasions like this. And one thing we usually don't do is talk about the study of history. And so that is something I am here to base my address on tonight. And the theme of my address in your honor is the school of history. So it is a commonplace, of course, to say one of the reasons we study history is to become better interpreters of our present. There's that cliched saying that those who do not remember their history are, of course, doomed to repeat it. Now, it's a dangerous oversimplification to say that history simply repeats itself. Knowledge of history, as you graduates have obtained through your studies here, is not sufficient to inform your actions. It's not sufficient to inform the actions of kings, queens, citizens, and statesmen. Every age must solve its own problems and respond to its own challenges. Inspiring as they may be, ancient Greeks, long dead Romans, and great Americans like Washington, Lincoln, or FDR, they can't solve our problems for us. The 19th century German professor and philosopher, G.W.F. Hegel, one of your favorites, no doubt, from senior year Humane Letters, emphasized the error in this commonplace way of thinking. Hegel may have been guilty of overstatement, but he writes in one passage in the preface to his Lectures on the Philosophy of History that every age, every event, every moment in world history is so entirely unprecedented that the past can provide zero insight into it. What does give us insight? Well, not all that surprisingly for a German professor, Hegel claims that it's only his unique philosophical system, detailed in thousands of pages of unreadable, jargon-laden prose, that can provide comprehensive understanding of the past, present, and future alike, interpreting and predicting with absolute and scientific certainty. As a great teacher of mine once said of Hegel, he's either got it exactly right or he's completely nuts. Not everything Hegel said was wacko, though. There's a flash of humor here and there. One of my favorite quips from that preface is where Hegel pokes fun at the moralizing pretensions of schoolmasters and history teachers, petty people who denounce someone like Alexander the Great for his violent ambitions and other moral faults, evidenced by his subjugation of Asia. The implication, of course, is that the school teacher is morally superior to Alexander, proven by the fact that not once in his entire teaching career has he ever subjugated Asia. Hegel also said the study of history was not to make us cleverer for next time, but to make us wiser for all time. Now, if I understand him correctly, I think the same thing could be said about your education here at Anthem Prep. Its purpose has not been to make you clever, not to train you for the needs of the moment or the present, not to prepare you for college and for jobs, but to help set you on a lifelong pursuit of wisdom and virtue. Not to make you smarter than fellow college freshmen next year, but to help you be wiser and happier for the rest of your lives. Now, another great teacher of mine once told me that, in his understanding, history was a laboratory. It was the lab in which the truth or falsity of political and moral philosophy could be tested. and verified or falsified. I like this idea. For while, of course, we can, in argument, demonstrate the evils of 20th century totalitarianism, we can empirically verify them too. Look at the horror, slaughter, famine, genocide, physical destruction, the moral degradation wrought by Soviet communism and German Nazi terror, and it is clear that those ideologies are false, bad, and hideously ugly. On the other hand, look at American growth, stability, material prosperity, the ability to survive a civil war, and the steady sharing of the blessings of liberty to ever greater numbers of its citizens. It may seem that the founders' endorsement of a balanced and mixed constitution, also found in the thinking of Aristotle, might have some truth to it. Look at the way that the bold and unprecedented experiment in ancient Athenian democracy turns into reckless war-making, factional strife, abuse of justice, and rule by demagogues, and the critiques of pure democracy made by Plato and James Madison alike seem to be verified. Read what Rousseau says about something he calls the general will of the people, some mysterious force which must be grasped and acted upon by the true legislator, even if the vast majority of the people are unaware that it is their general will. And then look at the violence unleashed upon the people in the France of the 1790s, or the Russia again of 1917, by a fanatical revolutionary minority claiming to be acting on behalf of those same people, most of whom opposed them. Was Rousseau's notion insightful, fruitful, true? We can read and discuss around the seminar table, as you have, but such theorizing can be, I might even say must be, complemented by careful observations in the lab of history. Now, the wonderful thing, of course, about the laboratory is it is a controlled environment. We can conduct our own experiments there in nation building, statecraft, war and peace, law, constitutions, revolution, and no one gets hurt. Or at least nobody new gets hurt. Hegel rightly likened history to a slaughter bench, an altar upon which countless lives and the happiness of entire peoples have been sacrificed. As sober students of history, we should keep this grave truth in our minds always, never rejoicing in it as twisted evil geniuses like Robespierre, Lenin, Stalin, and Hitler did. So graduates, I'd like to ask you to step into the lab with me one last time here at Anthem Prep. Let's go to a lab with Professor Thucydides. Recall, if you will, that dry and often difficult book that you read from your junior humane letters classes, that great History of the Peloponnesian War. Now, of course, I see already people eyes rolling, right? Everyone thinks Thucydides is no, you on the end there, I saw you. Everyone thinks Thucydides is no fun when compared to who? Herodotus. Everyone's right, by the way. But don't think for a minute that this judgment actually reflects poorly upon Thucydides. His history, which he consciously sketches in his opening chapters as a kind of anti-Herodotus, is an underrated masterpiece, a work of epoch-making and genre-forging genius, one of the most important books ever written. You were very lucky that you've read it. Now, while Herodotus is entertaining and dramatic and still very close to the epic tradition of poetry and storytelling, Thucydides is a real original. Sober, analytical, rational, a deep thinker about historical and political causes and effects. I prefer to think of Thucydides as the real father of history. That's a name sometimes called Herodotus. Herodotus is, to my mind, more the jolly old grandfather of history, telling tall tales and handing out treats to the children. Recall with me now Thucydides' great funeral oration of the Athenian leader Pericles, an inspiring vision of the balanced glory and prosperity of Athens in its golden age, a united and free society at its zenith. I quote from it at length. Thucydides has the great Athenian general say, "Our constitution does not copy the laws of neighboring states. We are rather a pattern to others than imitators. Our administration favors the many instead of the few. The laws afford equal justice to all in their private differences. Advancement in public life falls to reputation for capacity, class considerations not being allowed to interfere with merit. The freedom which we enjoy in our government extends also to our ordinary life. There, far from exercising a jealous surveillance over each other, we do not feel called upon to be angry with our neighbor for doing this or that or what he likes, or even to indulge in those injurious and scolding looks which cannot fail to be offensive, even though they inflict no real harm. But all this ease in our private relations does not make us a lawless people. Fear and respect are our chief safeguards against this, teaching us to obey magistrates and laws, particularly those laws that protect the injured, whether they are actually written down in the statute books or belong to that code which, although unwritten, cannot be broken without disgrace. We throw our city open to the world, and we never exclude foreigners from any opportunity of learning or observing. We cultivate refinement without extravagance, and knowledge without frivolity. Wealth we employ more for use than for vulgar display. Instead of looking on discussion as a stumbling block or hindrance to action, we think it is an indispensable preliminary to any wise political action at all. In our national enterprises, we present the singular spectacle of both daring and deliberation, each carried to its highest point. Although, in the rest of mankind, decision is usually the fruit of ignorance, and hesitation the fruit of reflection. In generosity, we are all equally singular. It is only the Athenians who, fearless of consequences, confer their benefits, not from calculations of interest or expediency, but in the confidence of our liberality. I stop the quotation there. You may recall at the climax of this address, Pericles proclaims that Athens is the school of Hellas, an education for the rest of Greece, a model of what Greeks can be. It is a vision that can educate us, a vision of a society that manages to be both free and law-abiding. Bold and active and thoughtful, reflective in its policies and politics. Prosperous and tough. Tolerant of different ways of life and equally committed to virtue and excellence. Somehow both pluralistic and united, open to foreigners, and vigorous in foreign wars when attacked. It is a beautiful and inspiring thing, a vision of a society that is orderly and free alike. Pericles concludes, speaking to his fellow Athenians, "You must yourselves realize the power of Athens and feed your eyes upon her from day to day until love of her fills your hearts. And then when all her greatness shall break upon you, you must reflect it was by courage, sense of duty, and a keen feeling of honor in action that men were enabled to win all of this for you." Sublime stuff. Of course, you remember what happens next. Just a matter of sentences after Pericles' speech is over, the historian Thucydides tells us of the first appearance of the devastating plague that ravaged Athens throughout that summer of the year 430. The beautiful portrait Pericles has painted of a balanced, healthy, and powerful Athens is replaced by scenes of horror. Corpses lying in the streets, fear and panic amongst the healthy, utter despair by the infected at their first signs of disease. Manners, religious rites, ancient customs in sudden and near universal disregard. A wave of criminality, as men ceased to fear law and legal punishment, certain that they, or better yet, all the judges, would die of disease before anyone could be brought to trial. It withers like a summer flower. It collapses like a house of cards. Pericles as Athens does not last. Pericles himself dies in that plague, but not before our historian Thucydides depicts the fickle Athenian people blaming him for all their problems and for the war with Sparta, which they once so enthusiastically supported, but no longer have the stomach for. After telling us of his death, Thucydides comments that Athens' failure to follow his restrained and moderate foreign policy brought it to ruin in the subsequent decades of war, a war that exhausted all of Greece before the final Athenian defeat. In those hundreds of pages that you had to read after that, that take us from Pericles' death in 430 to nearly the end of the war in 404, Thucydides now shows us not a noble and beautiful Athens, but a city that commits acts of outrageous savagery against its enemies. Think of that shocking Melian dialogue in which the arrogant and merciless Athenian delegate brazenly tells the helpless, defeated Milesians, "We will do whatever we want with you, because that is what the strong do to the weak. That is what they have always done and what they always will do." Our author shows us a once responsible and restrained Athens that for some reason trusts the outrageous fraud and rich upper-class charlatan Alcibiades, such appalling character and such charm, with its supreme political power. He shows us an Athens that makes a mockery of its own law and justice and starts visiting fratricidal revenge punishments on its good and faithful public servants for the slightest misfortunes of war. He shows us an Athens which, late in the conflict, detached from reality, under the sway of the despicable Alcibiades, foolishly gambles all of its strength upon that Sicilian expedition, an unnecessary, massive foreign campaign of conquest that is as audacious and as doomed as Napoleon or Hitler's invasions of Russia. From the glory of Periclean Athens to the depths of defeat, those Athenian prisoners thrown in the gravel pits to die, and the entire populace certain they will now be put to the sword just as they have treated others. It is a sobering history of downfall, the tragedy of Athens, just as capable of moving us to pity and fear as Oedipus or any of the other Greek tragedies. Now, if Pericles' great funeral speech is a beautiful picture of a balanced, prosperous, and healthy society, maybe the greatest such image from the ancient world, later on in the book, Thucydides also gives us a powerful, condensed, and shocking portrait of what it looks like when social order is completely torn apart. This passage is one of my favorites in all of the Western canon. It's that one about revolutions throughout Greece in Book 3. Here at this point, Thucydides is telling us it wasn't just Athens that fell apart. Every city in Greece was sent into upheavals, caught in the storm of the war between the Athenians and the Spartans. I quote from this passage at length. Thucydides writes, "The whole Hellenic world was convulsed. The sufferings which revolution entailed upon the cities were many and terrible, such as have occurred and will always occur as long as the nature of mankind remains the same. Revolution ran its course from city to city. Words had to change their ordinary meaning and to take that which was now given to them. Reckless audacity came to be considered courage of a loyal party supporter. Prudent hesitation, cowardice. Moderation, a cloak for unmanliness. The ability to see multiple sides of a question, incapacity to act on any. Frantic violence became the attribute of manliness. Preemptive plotting, justifiable self-defense. The advocate of extreme measures was always held to be trustworthy. His milder opponent, a man to be held in suspicion and contempt. To succeed in a plot or a scheme was to prove yourself clever. To detect or thwart a plot, real or imagined, still cleverer. But to refuse to do either was considered a betrayal of your party and cowardice before your adversaries. Revenge was held of more account than self-preservation. Oaths of reconciliation only held good as long as you had no other weapon at hand to kill your enemy. The leaders in the cities made the fairest professions, the one side with the cry of political equality and democracy, the other with a moderate conservatism and oligarchy. But they both sought prizes for themselves in those public interests which they pretended to cherish, and stopping at nothing in their struggles for ascendancy, engaged in excesses. In their acts of vengeance, they went to even greater lengths, not limiting themselves to what justice or the common good demanded. Religion was in honor with neither party, but the use of fair and lofty phrases to arrive at criminal ends was in high reputation. Meanwhile, the moderate part of the citizens perished between the two camps, either for not joining in the quarrel or because the envy of the opposing parties would not allow them to escape. Every form of iniquity took root in Greece by reason of troubles. The ancient simplicity into which honor so largely entered was laughed at and disappeared. Society became divided into camps in which no man trusted his fellow. Human nature, always rebelling against law, and now its master, gladly showed itself ungoverned in passion, above respect for justice, and the enemy of all authority. Indeed, men too often take upon themselves in the prosecution of their revenge to set the example of doing away with those general laws to which everyone can look for salvation in times of adversity, instead of allowing those laws to subsist against the day of danger when their aid may be required. I stop the quote there. This is an image every bit as frightening and sobering as Pericles' funeral speech is beautiful and inspiring. The author tells us that this kind of disorder will always occur because that's the direction that human nature tends. It starts with the abuse and manipulation of language. Next comes fanatical and unrestrained action. Then the factional spirit of party versus party in a winner-take-all battle. The respective visions of liberty and conservatism for the common good of all become empty slogans, barely covering each party's struggle to dominate. Law becomes a tool to punish and destroy fellow citizens, rather than as a common protector for all. Honor, honesty, decency, trampled upon and mocked. Trust and tolerance between fellow citizens vanish. The center does not hold. The moderate part perishes, swallowed up by radicalized factions, and the only choices left are between extremisms. So what is Thucydides' message? What's the lesson to be learned in this course in the School of History? What conclusion should we draw from these observations in the laboratory of the Peloponnesian War? In the true spirit of Anthem prep and Socratic inquiry, I will, of course, tell you nothing. No answers. You must think, discern, weigh, consider, criticize, and reflect. You must integrate what you have learned from the great books, what you have learned from your friends and classmates and teachers. You must integrate what you believe about the universe and humanity and what you see and experience around you. It is for you to discover, hypothesize, agree, disagree, or suspend judgment. But aim at nothing less than the truth. Accept no falsity, no nonsense, no party line, no philosophical system created by a German professor with delusions of omniscience. What is my message to you? Now, I believe I have a responsibility to say something here, not just to recapitulate a long-forgotten reading from 11th grade Humane Letters and answer your questions with more questions. My message to you, graduates, is this. Pericles boasted that Athens was the school of Greece. I urge you, be a school to your generation, an education to your peers, an example and inspiration to your elders. Teach your culture and your country and your bosses and your professors and your candidates vying for your votes and your elected leaders how they should be. Teach them how to be reflective, to eschew extremism of all sorts. Teach them how to be generous, fair-minded, how to trust their fellow citizens. Teach them what you have learned here at your school, that philosophical disagreement need not dissolve the deeper ties of friendship, that there is no intellectual argument that can't be smoothed over by a senior trip, a class play, singing together, or a good game of Foursquare. Teach your generation and your elders to respect impartial law and justice and moderation and self-restraint. Teach us that politics is not everything, that beautiful music, Shakespeare, a Euclidean proof, a Latin poem, or a Russian novel are vastly more important than fashion, faction, and party strife. Teach our world that harmony, concord, and political friendship in a nation, in a state, are rare and precious, and won only with difficulty over generations, and that they should never be thrown away for this or that cause of the moment. Graduates, I urge you to be that center, that moderate and tolerant and morally serious middle that is needed to keep every community and state together. Teach the world what you have learned from Socrates, that the pursuit of justice is not about seeking and punishing the alleged wrongs of others, but the right ordering of your own soul, about building the ideal city, the Kallipolis, inside you. Teach the world what you have learned from Dimitri, Ivan, and Father Zosima, that we are all guilty, that we all deserve some kind of punishment, and that we should thus accept hardship with humility, not with screams of protest over the smallest perceived slight or injury. Underlying it all, graduates, I borrow from Pericles, and I urge you, you must yourselves realize the power of this community, your class and your school. Feed your soul with the memory of these things from day to day, no matter how far away you travel. Then your love of this school and your gratitude for what she has given you will fill your hearts. Years from now, all her greatness shall break upon you, and you must reflect that it was out of love, courage, sacrifice, labor, duty, and the keen pursuit of the beautiful that your teachers and your parents built this school and made this possible for all of you. Graduates of 2019, take Anthem Prep with you as you leave. Take your school with you forever. Be a school to your generation. Teach the world.
Thank you, Mr. Ellison. I go off script for a moment, something I do best. Get myself in trouble. This group of seniors I have taught many years, and something Mr. Ellison, actually much of what Mr. Ellison said, resonated with a lot of our history. This piece that he ended on here of going with great hearts and what we have given you. I taught at least a portion of this group in 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 9th, and 11th grades. I know this class better than I know any class before. I promised myself I would stay composed. Whew, take a deep breath. I know this class far better than I know any other class, and probably will know any other class for the rest of time. I've been reflecting a lot lately on what is a school. You guys, as you go, take a piece. You take what Great Hearts, what Anthem Prep is this year with you. 2019 Anthem Prep will not continue on in next year. It's something that remains now and you take with you. I'm excited to see what you do with it as you go. Now, members of the class of 2019, I invite Mr. Stephen Philibom to the podium to call the roll of the graduates.
Faith Turner Bond. Kavya Balachandran. Noah Christopher Bedard. Preston Michael Blackledge. Faith Angelica Case. Max Charles Cash. Josephine Carolyn Crelly. Caleb Robert Dixon. Madison Maria Everson. Parker Hamilton Ferris. Nicole Julianne Garcia Figueroa. Keelan Andrew Gard. Pranity Guduru. Jacob Nolan Hansen. Denise Nicole Helfer. Anna Elizabeth Henshaw. Jay Lynn Joyner. Joseph Anwar Karaman. Zachary Robert Kukta. Olivia Faith LeClaire. Ethan James Lucas. Sneha Mikulaneni. Jacob Kenneth Miller. Kelly Macholsky. Gelsey Lee Murphy. Sophia Ilsa Palenque. Alex Paul Pericini. Brenna May Pillsbury. Prahasitha Reddy Panaka. Jillian Solar Pasnecki. Alexander Isaac Robinson. Michaela Joy Rowe. Jonathan Wayne Rust. Sabrina Brooke Seifert. Nicole Faith Shibata. Nalani May Summer. Georgia Ashlyn Valerie. Christian Anton Weissmuller. Rachel Eve Wolf.
Ladies and gentlemen, the graduates of the class of 2019. Now, for tonight's exhortation, we've asked a member of our community who is beloved by students and faculty alike. I myself will not soon recover from him leaving our midst. He's a lover of folklore and folk songs. He's an expert in all things Tolkien. He's the most loyal man I've ever met and probably ever will meet. To send you off with a farewell address, his final address, as an official part of our school, I invite Mr. William Bertain to the podium.
Thank you for your kind words, Mr. Goodrich. My dear graduates of Anthem Prep,
What a day this is. You have accomplished so very much, and it is proper and right to acknowledge all that you have done. You have come so very far, and we are so very proud of you. Our deepest and warmest congratulations to you all. We now come to the end of your high school education at Anthem Prep. In many ways, it has been a years-long quest, full of journeys, along with many of the greatest authors, artists, scientists, and mathematicians of Western civilizations. In practical terms, after a few weeks of relaxation, many of you will start the process of getting ready for college. College. That's the site of your next big quest, right? Well, in a sense, absolutely. But in another sense, this is not entirely correct. Granted, you will undertake challenges of an academic nature. You will have more homework to do. You will have new, exciting classes and content to encounter, and this is all well and good and right. I'm not even going to get into the challenges of a full-time job after college. We'll worry about that in 4 years. But that said, if we reduce our quest to just these things, to just mastery of more course content or making money, we are missing out as human beings. So where does your next quest truly reside? A few observations in tackling that. Now, I've referenced the notion of questing, and in doing so, well, you might have guessed it, and you may have picked up from what Mr. Goodrich said, and if you've spoken with me at any length or found yourself in the dean's office for whatever reason, whenever I think of questing, well, my mind instantly goes to the stories of J.R.R. Tolkien and his tales of Middle-earth. The Hobbit is in our curriculum. Maybe you've read The Lord of the Rings, and you may very well find these stories compelling, as many do. But just recently, while flipping through The Lord of the Rings, I came across a phrase that stood out to me. In the story, during celebrations after a penultimate victory, a minstrel steps forward and uses a phrase that seems so fitting for this moment, tonight. The minstrel speaks to the gathered free peoples, men, elves, dwarves, and, I quote, the great hearts of the Shire. Great hearts of the Shire. What a fitting phrase. For after all, has not Anthem Prep been our home, our Shire? And even with all the hard work and questing that you've done while here, maybe you feel there's something Shire-like about this place that you will take with you. After all, isn't Mr. Goodrich so very Gandalf-like? It is indeed a wide world out there. And in a certain sense, you are about to step out into that very same wide world, out your front door. Now, I would suggest that unlike Frodo and Sam, Pippin and Merry and Bilbo, you've already done a fair bit of questing, even before leaving the Shire of Anthem Prep. But as Bilbo remarks in song, the road goes ever on. So where does the next quest truly reside? I actually think you already know from the books you have read, but you also know it from living in and through this community. To examine this, let's consider, What is really at the root of the quest of Frodo and Sam to destroy the One Ring? One would be inclined to say that it is the perennial struggle of good versus evil, and that is certainly true. But where does that struggle itself really reside? Oh, that it was so easy and simple that there was some dark lord doing evil things with an army of orcs, and we could form a merry band of adventurers to thwart them. Though this is starting to sound like we might, from what I understand from the senior trip and the role-playing game experiences I heard about, we might need a new DM as the game leader. If it were that simple, but it's not. In reflecting on this notion of questing, I recall a passing conversation I was involved in this year. The question came up, what is the Lord of the Rings really about? Someone pointed out that it's about the friendship of Frodo and Sam. In reflecting on this, I think that that is so very true. Friendship. That's what Lord of the Rings is about. And that is exactly where the perennial human quest always lies. In friendships, and the ways we relate to those men and women in whatever community we are in. That has been, is, and will continue to be the human arena of greatest danger, greatest sorrow, greatest joy, and greatest victory. You have equipped yourself well for this quest. You have developed and enacted friendship and positive relationships in your acquaintances. You have taken on a lot, and now you are at the end of this particular quest. The quest at Anthem Prep to develop great minds, a better understanding of the world, to develop moral and intellectual virtue, and most importantly, the quest to develop your hearts. The quest to develop your capacity to love nobly. And so it is, my dear great hearts of the Shire, we send you into a world where these very challenges of the human heart will only continue, but you are ready to face them in this new way, well prepared. You are well prepared, and you have demonstrated that you will be able to tackle these challenges and rise victorious. You have shown that others can count on you. Others will count on you again. In the pursuit of truth, you have shown that you are not afraid to speak up and correct your friends and comrades when they are wrong, not out of a desire of proving yourself better, but because you care for those around you and you want them to understand too. You want them to experience the truth as well. Many in the future will depend on this very care you have shown. This heart that you have shown for others. You have also shown humility in receiving charitable correction. Your example of a humble heart will lead others to likewise be inspired to humility in accepting the truth. You have shown that you can work as a team. Others will need your comradeship and leadership in the future. Most importantly, you have shown you can truly care for one another. You have shown true charity. And in a world that is so full of confusion and strife, you will be called on to do so again. And there are so very many whom you know and whom you do not know, who will be better off for knowing you, for coming to know you, for having you in class, or on their team, or in the workplace, or as part of their family. My dear graduates, Great Hearts of the Shire, 2019. We send you on a new quest. We are so very excited to see in the years to come how you will fulfill it, as we know that you will. Once again, our deepest congratulations to you, the class of 2019. Our thoughts, prayers, and goodwill are with you now and always.
Graduates, it has come time for us to part ways. On behalf of Anthem Preparatory Academy, I bid you all a very fond farewell.